Chapter 5. Last week we mentioned that chapter 4 brings forward the reality that God the Father, as the Creator, is worthy of praise and worship. And I said then chapter 5 brings forward the reality that God the Son, as the Redeemer, is worthy of praise and worship. So that's kind of the overarching reality in chapter 5. We're going to look at the entire chapter today. So the most important truth in chapters 4 and 5 is God's sovereignty over the world and its history, where we see communicated in chapter 4 him sitting on the throne, reigning as creator and sustainer of everything which exists by his sovereign will. And then in chapter 5 now we see that the central figure of this God's sovereign will and plan for his creation is Jesus Christ and his victorious sacrifice on the cross. That's what we're going to see here. Now, like I mentioned last week, Ezekiel 1 was significant in properly understanding what was going on in Revelation 4. We're going to continue to see that same thing, that these visions in the Old Testament provide us clarity, or that's the bank of information that we're to pull from to understand these symbolic images in Revelation. So Ezekiel 1 was critical last week. We're going to see here in Revelation 5, Daniel 7 is also critical, as well as Ezekiel 2 is also critical in understanding what these images in Revelation 5 are communicating, or what they are to mean. So Ezekiel 2 and Daniel 7 are going to be critical. Specifically Daniel 7, there's so many similarities to Revelation 4 and 5 to what's going on in Daniel 7. Revelation 4 or 5 alludes to the visions of Daniel 7. I'll give you some examples. Both in Revelation 4 and 5 as well as in Daniel 7 spend a few words introducing the vision. Both have a throne set in heaven with God seated on the throne. Both offer symbolic descriptions of God's appearance on the throne. Both have fire before the throne and heavenly servants around the throne. Both have a book or books open before the throne. Both have a divine messianic figure approaching God's throne to receive authority to reign forever and ever over a kingdom of all peoples, nations, and tongues. Daniel and John both experience emotional distress as a result of the vision. We're going to see John weeps. So both Daniel and John experience emotional distress as a result of what they're seeing, what they're viewing. Both depict believers being given divine authority over a kingdom, and both end with mentioning God's eternal reign. Again, why is this important? Because it provides us clarity, it gives us guidance, it gives us the map to understand what's happening in Revelation 4 and 5. It gives us the bank of information to properly interpret the images that we have. Just like we have a bank of information right now that we know that Jesus is known as a lion and believers are known as sheep. And so that bank of information is used to properly process that painting on the wall. So that's why these visions in Ezekiel 1 and 2 and Daniel 7 here in 4 and 5 are so important. What it also does is it continues to communicate and solidify the reality that the Bible is one complete story. They're not in opposition to each other, the Old and New Testament, but they are cohesive parts of one story. And the central figure of the story isn't you. It's Christ, and that's the point. And I say that, you know, jokingly, because there's a lot of pastors that are bringing forward messages that are man-centered. It's about you. It's about you. It's about you. It's not about you. It's about Christ. Like, the messages are, you're the David figure, and so what stones do you need to pick up and slay the giants in your life? The Goliath, the giants in your life. No, that's not us. We're the Israelites on the mountain, unable to beat the Goliath. Christ is the David figure. That is a Christ-centered preaching versus a man-centered preaching. And so this brings forward the reality that Jesus Christ is the focus and fulcrum of God's intent for all humanity. From Genesis to Revelation, it's about Jesus, and that's what these visions do. By connecting us to those visions in the Old Testament, it continues to solidify that reality. It's about Christ. So, God's divine plan for the world is one of justice and redemption, judgment and salvation. And so the realities and truths put forward in this chapter point us to that reality, that God's plan is justice and redemption, judgment and salvation. So today in chapter 5, what we're going to see, we're going to break it down this way. We're going to see in verses 1 through 4 a cause for weeping. We're going to see in verses 5 through 7 conquering and worthy Lamb is revealed, and then the celebration and worship of God and the Lamb in verses 8 through 14. Because it's such a large chunk of scripture, we're going to read section by section. Now, if we're going to boil this down to one main idea, it is all creation continues to worship the Lord God and His Christ for their plan to judge sin and redeem God's people through the sacrifice of the Lamb of God. All creation continues to worship the Lord God and His Christ for their plan to judge sin and redeem God's people. How? Through the sacrifice of the Lamb of God. Okay, verse 1. Let's look at verses 1 through 4, where we see a cause for weeping. John writes, "Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?' And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it." Like I've already mentioned, these visions are to be understood symbolically and not literally. One example of that is if you understand this vision literally, i.e. John is literally seeing God the Father sitting on a throne, the problem that you have is that God the Father does not literally have a right hand. Does that make sense? Right there, it's clear. He's seeing an image that is symbolically being used to symbolize or represent God the Father, because God the Father does not have a body and does not have a right hand. That, again, is additional evidence that chapter 1, verse 1 is to be understood, that chapter 1, verse 1 says that these visions are to be understood symbolically. Got it? All right. So what does it mean? What does the scripture, the bank of information that we have to pull from to understand, what does the right hand of God mean? What does the Bible teach and refer to or use the right hand to communicate? Well, the right hand in scripture is seen to communicate power and authority and honor, but even more focused than that, Psalm 110 verse 1 and Psalm 118, verse 16, bring forward prophecies about the Messiah. And in both of those passages, the right hand is mentioned, referencing the Messiah. For example, in Psalm 110, verse 1, David says, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand." The Lord, God the Father, says to my Lord, God the Son, sit at my right hand. So we see in the scriptures that the right hand is communicating power and authority and honor, but even more specifically, it's a messianic reference to Jesus. Amen? Amen. All right, so that's understanding this image that John said, understanding it symbolically and using the scripture to get the definition of what it's symbolizing. So the right hand, power and authority, and the messianic connection. So there are two things that I want to make sure that we think through in this particular section, verses 1 through 4, and they are the scroll itself. What's the scroll? What's it supposed to be communicating? And why does an unopened scroll cause John to weep? Two questions that I want us to think through. What's the scroll, and why is John weeping because it's unopened? Okay? So let's talk about the scroll first. What do we recognize about the scroll? It has writing on the inside and on the back, and it's sealed with seven seals. Well, Daniel 7 and Ezekiel 2 also have books or scrolls mentioned in them. So there are similarities in the descriptions of what John's seeing in Revelation 4 and 5, and those characteristics and those images, those descriptions, are also found in the images and the visions in Ezekiel 1 and 2 and Daniel 7. So he's screaming at us, read Ezekiel 1 and 2, read Daniel 7 to understand what's going on here. And in all these passages, there's a book or there's scroll. So let's look at Daniel 7 first to see what's going on in the vision and what's happening. What do the books contain to better understand what's the scroll contain in Revelation 5? Daniel 7, verses 9 through 10. As I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took a seat. His clothing was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was fiery flames. Its wheels were burning fire. A stream of fire issued and came out from before him. 1,000,000 served him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The court sat in judgment, and the books were open. What did the books contain in Daniel's passage? Judgment. Ezekiel 2, 9 through 10. And when I looked, behold, a hand was stretched out to me. Sound familiar? Daniel 5, he's on the throne, and his right hand stretched out with a scroll. And when I looked, behold, a hand was stretched out to me, and behold, a scroll of a book was in it. And he spread it before me, and it had writing on the front and on the back. And there were written on it words of lamentation and mourning and woe. So what's the scroll in Revelation 5 consist of? Judgment, lamentation, woe, mourning. Because some people interpreted it as being, it's the title deed to the earth, the scroll. And it's showing that God the Father is giving Jesus the authority over the earth. Well, that's a true statement. God the Father is given authority to God the Son, and Jesus has authority over the earth. But that's not what the scroll means. It's very clear. All of these images and the characteristics of what John's seeing points us to Daniel 7 and Ezekiel 2, and both of them have books or scrolls, and one of them has it written on the front and the back. Sound familiar? And what's the content? Judgment. And if you just continue through the book of Revelation, you see the reality of that. When the seals are popped open, what's happening? Judgment is being poured out. Wrath is being poured out. So allowing Daniel's vision and Ezekiel's vision to inform John's vision, it becomes clear what the scroll consists of. God's plan and purposes regarding judgment. And the fact that it had writing on the inside and on the back shows two things. That God's plan and purpose regarding judgment are abundant and precise. Now, what about the seven seals? Because it's writing on the inside and on the back. That's communicating that it's abundant, right? It's precise. The fact that it has seven, what's seven? Full, complete, total. That it is, this seven seals most likely is communicating that this judgment is perfect. It is complete. It is full. Make sense? All right. So another component to this scroll being opened is that only the one who is worthy or has the authority can open it. So just like a will during this time or a letter from one king to another, right? They would use, they would roll it up and they would use this, you know, the wax to seal it. And only the one who was worthy to open it, if it was a will, only the one who, you know, the possessions was left to, would be able to have, has the authority and worthiness to open and break the seal. So the same thing here. The question isn't, is anyone strong enough to break the seal? The question is anyone worthy enough to break the seal, right? Only the one who is worthy to break the seal. Now the scroll, if it represents the plan of God in judgment on the world and the blessings for God's people, then it would be communicating that the plan of God is unrevealed and unexecuted until the one who is worthy opens it. And that's what John is witnessing. To open the scroll would mean to reveal God's plan of judgment and redemption and carry it out. But no one's found at this point worthy enough. No one is found worthy enough to break the seal and reveal and put into motion the plan of God in judgment and the warnings and the woes that come, the lamentations and the woes that come. No one is worthy to do it. So that causes John to weep. And that's the other thing I wanted to say. Why does an unopened scroll cause John to weep? John desires to see the plan of God of redemption and judgment to be revealed and to be unraveled. But no one is worthy. Because of this, John is overcome with this sadness. So why is John crying? Because he wants judgment to happen. Remember, what's the purpose of revelation? Is to provide comfort and peace, right, to persecuted believers. Remember, don't forget that, persecuted believers. So there are people, John's one of them, because remember, he's been banished to the island of Patmos by people who are in opposition to Christ and the proclamation of the gospel. And there are people that he's writing to that are persecuting believers. And so judgment is coming. There's a longing to see judgment fall and the wrongs to be made right. Persecution and those who persecute to receive the just punishment. And we're going to see that the souls under the altar here as we continue in chapter 6, crying out, when will you avenge our blood? When will you pour your judgment out? And he says, just wait a little bit longer. So there is a desire for this to come about, this judgment to come about. There's a desire for it to be made clear amongst all creation that Jesus, the slain lamb, is the focus and fulcrum of God's plan. Does that make sense? And so John desires to see that. There is an anticipation and a longing for the one who is worthy. So as you're reading this for the first time, You're caught up in this, I want to see it. Who is worthy? Who is the one? So it's setting the stage to elevate the one who is worthy, who of course is Christ. Does that make sense? And that emotion and that desire for the one to be revealed, the one who is worthy, and to bring that judgment is creating in John that weeping and that longing for it. It's beautiful. And creating in the readers that desire to see the one who is worthy. Who is worthy to break the seal? And then we find out here in the next section. The conquering and worthy lamb is revealed in verses 5 through 7. Let's read it. And one of the elders said to me, weep no more. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. The Gospel of John began its narrative of Jesus' life by recording John the Baptist's words. John the Baptist says what? Behold, the Lamb of God. Now in Revelation, John the Apostle is given a heavenly vision where he beholds the Lamb of God. So the elder says the same thing as John the Baptist, right? Whoa. Behold. But he doesn't say the Lamb of God. What does he say? The Lion of the tribe of Judah. So the lamb is the lion. Amen? He says, the elder says, there's no more need to weep. Because the one lion of the tribe of Judah, or the root of David, has conquered. So the elder brings forward truths about Christ to show his messianic qualifications. And these messianic qualifications are put forward in the Old Testament and taught all the way back in the Old Testament. And they teach that the Messiah would be from the tribe of Judah and as well as be the root of King David. So let's talk about the line of the tribe of Judah. Where does that connect us? Well, that's clear a fulfillment of the prophecy put forward in Genesis 49. Genesis 49, Jacob blesses his son Judah, referring to him and his future tribe as lion's cub, and a lion. Jacob also says that in the future, the scepter and ruler staff will not depart from Judah until he to whom it belongs shall come, and the obedience of the nations shall be his. Who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus. Amen? Only Jesus fulfills that prophecy. And so, and then the root of David connects us to Isaiah 11, where we see a messianic prophecy that says the Messiah will come from the stem of Jesse. The stem of Jesse is King David. Make sense? Paul tells us in Romans 1:3 that Jesus was born a descendant of David according to the flesh. And the genealogies in Matthew 1 and Luke 3 confirm that Jesus was a descendant of David both on his stepfather's side. Who's his stepfather? Joseph. Right? By legal standpoint, as well as his mother's side, Mary, by physical standpoint. Okay, so he fulfills that prophecy as well. So John is told to look at the lion. But he turns and he sees a lamb. So the conquering lion is the slain lamb. It's one and the same. It's two images that are symbolically referring to one person. That's Jesus. Amen? He's told to look for the lion, but he sees a lamb. It's the same. So the image of the lamb John was given in the vision is one that is unique to what lambs normally look like. What are some characteristics of this lamb? This lamb that he sees is different than lambs that he has seen in his life. The first difference is that it's been slain. So what could that image have looked like? He could have had his throat slit, or there could have been blood all over him, communicating that he had been slain or sacrificed, similar to what it would have looked like in the temple on the altar. What does that do? That slain lamb, the bloody lamb, that connects us to Exodus 12, the Passover. Amen? Again, fulfillment and reaching into the Old Testament, reaching into the bank of information and making connections to what he's seeing and he's witnessing with his eyes. What's the other difference that this lamb that he sees has compared to lambs that he's normally seen? Well, he has seven horns. Not trumpets, but like horns, right? So what does that mean? What does that communicate? Well, Deuteronomy 33:17 references horns, and in that text, it's a communication of power and authority in judgment. There is a goring going on in Deuteronomy 33:17 by the horns that's mentioned. It will gore them with horns. So that's communicating power and authority in judgment. What do the seven eyes communicate? Well, that's complete sight and sees all things, right? Seven being complete. But John gives us the interpretation himself. Because these are John's word. Now, John interprets the seven eyes and the seven horns. He says the sevens are that they are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. We've already established what the seven spirits of God being sent out all the earth refers to. Who does it refer to? The Holy Spirit. Right? It refers to the Holy Spirit. So it is the Holy Spirit that is enacting the will of the Lamb across all of the earth. The will of what? What's the will of the Lamb's? What's the Lamb's will? Judgment. Amen? So it is the Holy Spirit, the complete, full, total, divine Holy Spirit that is enacting, who sees all, who's working the will of God throughout all of the land, bringing judgment forward. That's what's being communicating there. And so Jesus' power and authority and worthiness is clearly communicated in verse 7 when he goes and he takes the scroll out of the right hand of him who is seated on the throne. This is an image. This isn't a literal event. This is an image communicating literal truths. Remember, God the Father doesn't have a right hand. The other thing that I thought about is, how does a lamb take a scroll? Does he walk up and with his mouth? Does this lamb have opposable thumbs where it can actually literally reach? We're not to understand this literally. It's symbolic language. Chapter 1, verse 1 tells us to do that. Does that make sense? Man, is it so good. All right, let's move on to verses 8 through 14, where we see a celebration and worship of God and the Lamb. We're going to look at verse 8 first. Verse 8, and when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. So we see John interpreting there, but we'll get to that in a minute. All right, the four living creatures and the elders all fall down and worship. John mentions that they most likely, the elders, are holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense. So what's going on with the harps? And what's going on with the incense, the bowls of incense? Well, the presence of harps connects us to 1 Chronicles chapter 25. And in 1 Chronicles 25, we see Levites, who were priests, fulfilling their priestly duties by playing harps in worship. Okay, so that's a connection to what was going on. So it's just worship. It's put forward by the priests in in 1 Chronicles 25. Now, the golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints, also connects us to the Old Testament and shows us how John is again interpreting these visions. He's seeing these things, and he's thinking when he sees the bowls of incense, he thinks of Psalm 141, verse 2, where David prays to God and says, "May my prayer be set before you like incense." So in the vision, John sees the bowls full of incense and then uses the Old Testament to interpret the vision for us, thus giving us a blueprint for us on how we're to interpret all of the visions using the Old Testament and using the visions that were put forward in the Old Testament. Ezekiel, Daniel, Isaiah, Zechariah, all of these that we'll go through. So he makes the connection for us because he says, which are the prayers of the saints. He's interpreting what he saw in those words. He sees it, and he goes, that's the prayer of the saints, and he interprets it for us. Let's look at verse 9 through 14, the last section. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom of priests to your God, and they shall reign on earth." Then I looked, and I heard around the throne the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen," and the elders fell down and worshiped. So in verses 9 through 14, what we see is a heavenly song of celebration come forward from every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea. And what do they do? They praise the Lamb because he is worthy. So what did the Lamb do that made him worthy? He died as the sacrifice, as the redeeming sacrifice, as the Lamb of God, right? That's what made him, that's what's causing this hymn to spring forward. This is a hymn that's celebrating the crucifixion of the Lamb. That's the means by which he's worthy because he's God, but the means by which he redeemed sinners from every tribe, every tongue, every nation, the means by which that happened was the cross. And so this is a hymn about the crucifixion and his worthiness in that. The cross brought death to the Lamb and at the same time celebration in heaven. The Lamb is worthy not because he kills all the enemies of God in battle, but because he offered himself to be killed as the atoning sacrifice, so that the justice and wrath and judgment of God for my filthy wickedness would be satisfied and I could be forgiven and redeemed back to my Creator. Not just for Jews did he do this. He says right there, every tribe and language and people and nation. And to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. This is proclaimed to highlight the divine position that this Lamb holds, that he is God. Amen? It's that the descriptions that's given to God the Father, we see given to the Lamb, communicating his deity. Now again, in verse 10, and you made them a kingdom of priests. So in Exodus 19:6, we see that Israelites being referred to as a kingdom of priests. But in Revelation 5:10, who's the them that a kingdom of priests has been made? A couple of words before that, at the end of verse 9. And by your blood, that's the means in which the Lamb redeems or ransoms people from God. Every tribe and language and people and nation. So not only are the Jews then made as a kingdom of priests, but it is all tribes, all tongues, all nations because of the means by which. And so there are sinners that will be redeemed from every tribe, every tongue, every nation. It does not mean that all tribes and all tongues and all nations and all people inside those will be redeemed, no. But there are people in every tribe, every tongue, and every nation that will be redeemed. Not just Jews. This isn't a universal every single human being. No. It's every nation, tribe, and tongue has people in them that will be redeemed throughout history. So like I mentioned earlier, Jesus is the focus and fulcrum of God's intent for all humanity. Therefore, one takeaway from this is to ask the question, is he your fulcrum and focus of your life? He's God's fulcrum and focus for the plan for every one of his redeemed. Is he your focus and fulcrum? Do you understand what is coming upon the world in the form of judgment? Do you see the glorious gift of salvation and forgiveness offered to you in the Lamb of God who was slain on your behalf? Do you see the magnificence of Christ? Do you worship him like the elders and the cherubim do? Because the reality is all creation, including you, we are barreling forward towards a face-to-face meeting with our Creator. We are all on a direct collision course with our Creator. And does that fact cause you to shrink in fear, or does it cause you to bust out in celebration like the passage that we have before us? Your answer to that question will provide clarity, I think, on as to where you stand with God. I can't wait. Can't wait to see him and bust out in awe and in celebration of the one who redeemed this wretched sinner from the wrath that he deserves. I can't wait. Let's pray. Father, we are in awe of the beauty of this image that John was given to communicate the worthiness and the means by which the Lamb redeems by dying. And so, Lord, we pray that you would help us to continue to see that the Christ of God is worthy of our worship and our awe and our adoration. Thank you for your word and how the Holy Spirit uses that to continue to add fuel and fire to our hearts and our minds to love him more and more. We love you, Lord. Help us to be faithful to you this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.